Amen. Go to Acts 2, 42 through 47. We know that we're in our series, Devoted. Everybody say Devoted.
Devoted.
A Life of Worship.
Life worship.
Yeah, that's our series title. I'm going to give you the one, give you the whole thing today. And it says, they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions, watch this now, and were sharing them with all, as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. Now go over to Hebrews 13, 15 through 16 real quick. Hebrews is in the back of your Bibles in the New Testament. It's right before James. Amen. If you don't know, just look in the table of contents. It's all good. Hebrews 13, 15 through 16. And it reads, through him then, that's through Jesus, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that give thanks to his name. And do not neglect doing good and sharing, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased.
Yes.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today. God, let the simplicity of this word sink into our hearts and transform our lives. Let us be different, Lord God, when we leave out of here.
Yes.
Let us see who we really are in you. Help us, Lord God. God, we don't just want to be hearers of your word. We want to be doers, God.
Yes,
God. Circumcise our ears that we may hear, our hearts that we may receive. Loose us, God, to do your will. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Look at somebody. Now, it's not good English, but look at somebody and say, I'm a do-gooder.
I'm a do-gooder.
Now ask them, are you a do-gooder? I know every now and then you just gotta do it all. Here's the thing, when we're looking at this text, and to catch everybody up, because you're gonna have to understand where we've been to catch up where we are, because we started this series by being devoted. Go ahead and put in my spirit that what happens is people come and we join churches and we get hyped for a minute, right? But it's the continuance, it's the consistency that helps us make things happen. It's the consistency, right? It's the consistent me showing up. It's the consistent when I don't feel good, I still come to Bible study. It's not about necessarily how I feel, amen? It's about who he is. And so we talked about the issue that we started off with Abraham. And what we found out, what I said was devoted, right? A life of worship. And what I've done, I've read several times that it says sacrifice. And so to catch everybody up, what you have to understand is that God said, Abraham, bring me your son for sacrifice. And when God said, bring me your son for sacrifice, he did just that, but Abraham didn't call it sacrifice. Abraham called it worship, which now lets me know I can't say I'm not worshiping if I'm not sacrificing. So then it lets me know that worship is not just me coming in with music. Worship is whether or not I'm willing to give up something when he asks for it. Worship is, he says, Dominique, bring me what I want. And I don't argue with him, I bring him what he wants. So watch this. We want everything, but we don't want to sacrifice. And so we find out, I'm going to translate. So we talked about how Abraham walked his son up the hill. We talked about how we look at it like Isaac is a little baby. And really, Isaac is not a little baby right here. Really, Isaac, my Northeast basketball team, Rihanna, is your age. He's really probably between 15 and 20 years old. Now, here's the thing. It's one thing to worship something, a sacrifice something you give easily. This is good right here. It's a good thing that y'all here today. Because, see, it's easy for me to quit when I ain't putting nothing in it. See, when I ain't putting no sweat into it, I can easily quit. But when I done gave up everything, while everybody else at home talking all that mess, I'm the one coming to practice at 5 in the morning. I'm the one do all this. So you can talk, but you ain't gave up nothing. See, that's where pride come in at a little bit. I'm talking about good pride. I'm talking about that healthy dose of, man, I done gave up something to be here. But what does this have to do just with Abraham? It's because Abraham had prayed and waited 25 years. 25 years for his son, and then God said, bring him to me. Now, here's the thing. He not only waited 25 years, he also lived with the promise for 15 to 20 years. So it's one thing to get the promise here, but what did you do when you done got comfortable with the promise? And God say, still bring that to me. So Abraham, being who God is, knowing who God is, knowing who he is, he did it. Can you imagine waiting 25 years for something? Living with it for 15 to 20. And God said, get up. Can you walk away from it all to have it all? Can you give it all to have it all? Hey, this is the intro. I ain't even got the text yet. And so what happened is, so we find out there, because I had to sit the president, we can't say I'm worshiping if I'm not sacrificing. I can't say I'm devoted to God if I'm not giving anything to God. I can't say I love God and I don't sacrifice my behavior every now and then. Right. Let me come to where you at. See, I can't say I love God and I know his words say don't fornicate and I ain't willing to give up fornication. That's all right. I struggled with it too. Amen. I ain't beating up nobody. See, I can't say I love God. And he said, give me my tithe, and I'm sitting here tripping. Right. Amen. Amen. So we moved from that, and we went to David. We talked about how David came in, and we gave the first part of the thing by Hebrews 13:15. He said, you should give with the sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of your lips. Now, what helps with this is that 1 Peter 2:9 says that you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. Here's the thing, Quintarius. He didn't say that you will be. He said you are. And see, what happens is the enemy wants to keep us from knowing who we are. So you keep trying to walk out being a G and a gangster and a boss and all that. But God said, no, you're a royal priesthood. You can't have it both ways. Either you're going to be holy or you're not going to be holy. And holy don't mean I got to be all quirky. It just means I'm separated. See what I did? He takes what's unholy, puts his hand on it, and make you holy. You can't make yourself holy. What happens is I become what he tells me I am. Here we go. Since he said, he's not a man that you should lie, nor the son of man that you should repent. If I say you holy, you holy. The issue is the streets and everybody else are trying to let you know you ain't so such and much. No, I'm all that in a bag of chips in him, no. Not outside of him. I got to be in him. And see, when I'm in him, I can walk like him. And the reason why I can't walk like him, because I'm not in him. My heart's not changed. And so now he said, so David figured out, okay, David said, okay, what are we doing right here? So that was the Acts 2, where 42 come in through 47, EJ. So what happened was David was going to get the Ark of the Covenant. See, the Ark of the Covenant had been lost 70 years. 70 years, the presence of God is not in Israel, but Deacon Mo, they still going through the ritual. It's kind of like some of us. We come to church and go through the ritual, but his presence ain't present. See, they still in Israel. They still slaughtering animals. They still doing all that, which lets me know I can give all I want, but if my heart ain't in it and his presence ain't present, it ain't nothing anyway. You see what I'm saying? And so David said, look, man, it's been 70 years. We hadn't had the chief thing that's supposed to be worshiping about. How are you going to worship in the main item of the worship is not there? That's how we are now. We come to church and we make it about us instead of about him. You see, you say, as long as I can come to church, I'm good. But he said, if I'm not there, it is what it is. He said, behold, I stand at the door. Hit a knock. Let me in. Is God in your church? But first of all, how did the ark get stolen? We're just walking up now. I'm just going through the introduction. The ark got stolen because Eli's two sons, they say that I was going to preach a message one time. I was going to call it Pulpit Pimps and Empty Entertainers. But I ain't preached it yet. And I was going to preach it at a leadership conference because what happened, I do this with grace because we all struggle with something. And so what happened was Eli's two sons were priests. Eli didn't correct them. Because what Eli's two sons were doing, they were taking off of the fat that was supposed to come and eating it for themselves, and they were sleeping with women at the entrance of the tent. So what it was, that there was no holy leadership in Israel. And so what happened was, when it was time for the Philistines to come up to fight, they used God's presence as what? As a good luck charm. And see, that's kind of like what we do. We don't call on God till we in trouble. We don't call in God till the bill due, the test got to be passed, or you know, I'm sick. But see, so that's what they did. They said, oh, it's time to walk. We know what to get us to battle. We'll just take the ark with us. But what happens when you take your good luck charm and it don't work like you think it's supposed to work? See, that's how we treat God. We treat God like a good luck charm. I just need you when I'm in trouble. I don't need you when my bank account full. Matter of fact, I won't even show up. I don't need you long as my wife talking to me. But when she stop, I'm going to pray. When all along, I should be having this relationship. Because there's some things he may allow me to go through because he want me to look like him. We've been taught a God that's like Santa Claus. And he's not like Santa Claus. He says, to get you to look like my son, I might withhold some things because I want that little right thing right there is we're going to bring you to me to pray. Amen. See, God wants more relationship than he wants your ritual. Oh, wow. And so what we said, that's why we heard some, that's why y'all keep hearing the cry. I mean, I remember saying, I'm so extra a little bit. It's because when David brought back in the Ark of the Covenant, David, the king, was leading worship. And David wasn't coming in with a two-step. David was jumping around. When you study, David was jumping around and twirling. He's the king of the land, and saying, guess what? I can worship. Matter of fact, he said David had on a linen ephod, which meant this. David ain't got on his king little apparel right now. David said, guess what? I'm a priest at the moment. See, in God's presence, I ain't nobody. I'm a priest. And what priests do is offer sacrifices. See, it don't matter whether or not the praise team is pumped up or not. What matters is I'm a priest and he tell me to proclaim his excellencies. So when I proclaim, that means I come out of my mouth with something. It ain't got to be crunk for me to praise. What happens is, whether or not anybody show up, whether or not the drum is on top, whether or not Jess is playing the guitar, I'm a priest. I offer this unto him. See, that's why some of us, we show up just for the word and we miss it because now it's all about me. But when you show up, you should say it's all about him so he can feed me. So what we've done is made him into our jackpot. We made him into cash 3. We made him into cash 4. If I can just get the right numbers, I can get the right thing out of him. But when you realize this is who I be, it's who I be. It don't even matter. You ain't got. See. I told you we can tell you whether or not you're a praiser by whether or not you're pregnant. Cause it says, "Let Judah go first." Right? And I gave it. Did I give it? Yeah, I gave it last week. He said that Judah means praise. Yada. In Hebrew, it means to grab hold. It means to watch. It's the same word that Adam knew Eve. And I gave that example about tomorrow, remember? I gave this example about tomorrow. I'm just catching y'all up so y'all can be with us, amen. So I gave this example about tomorrow. And I said that Tamar was married to one of Judah's sons. The son died. Then she married another one. He died. Now one son went in. He didn't die. The other son, he did his duties. See, you had to get permission slip when you're in school. To see, can you go through some educational classes? So I'm not naive and I think they don't know about it. I just want to be in order. So the other son went in and did his business, but he pulled out and spilled his seed into the ground. God killed him. Because he said, you don't waste seed. See, what some of us do, we take holy things and put it on our flesh. So we take, we can impregnate people. The word of God, and instead of putting it in their, and trying to put it in their heart, we took it in their flesh, and we still don't get nothing spiritual. Hence, we have carnal Christians and not spiritual Christians. Because you want to be crunk, but not holy. But so, let me keep going. He did that, Stacy. And so, guess what she said? Okay, I can't get a son. Guess what she did? She dressed herself up like a harlot, and she waited by the road. I'm still about Judah about being praised. I know where I'm at. We're talking about sacrifice. I know where I'm at, Quinn. So what happened was she set herself by the road. Judah came by. Judah did some things. Tamar ended up getting up pregnant. Watch this now. So what happened was she said, she came and she told Judah, I'm pregnant. And then she said, Judah said, by who? Remember, Judah means praise. She said, by you. Now, watch this. See, the Bible, I told you, the Bible is scandalous. You ain't got to watch Empire. Just read the Bible. Because, notice, to catch y'all up, Tamar is his daughter-in-law. But he went into the daughter-in-law not knowing he was the daughter, I'm trying to figure that out. But anyway, so she said, well, how do you know it by me? He proved it. So what she did, she had his signature, and she said his sign. What you saying, Pastor? We can tell if you've been praising if you pray. Because Judah means your dog. And so the reason why you don't have no fresh ideas, because you're not a praiser. You can't hide when you've been praising. See, because why? His signature is on it. She said, well, tell me whose are these? Judah couldn't deny it. So why this? If I can tell whether or not you dry or not on whether or not you've been praising and worshiping in your shower. I can tell whether or not when you get up early and spend time with God. Because what happened is, see what I did? And once you get pregnant, you can hide it for a little while. But after a while, you can't hide it. Men can't relate to this, but you ever been pregnant and want nobody to know? But after a while, that's when you get infused thinking, well, guess what? If I've been with him, this is the whole point of the matter. If I've been with him, I can't hide it. See, I can try to hide it, but Jeremiah says, like fire shot up in my bone. It's like, I got to walk. See, why this? You can't tell me nothing about him because I've been with him. It's one thing to talk about him. It's another thing to be with him. I'm just being extra because we're still in the introduction. So David was extra. David said, it don't matter because I'm the king. It don't matter because I'm Dominique Johnson, pastor of King of Life, being in leadership making. Being in the middle of Georgia, reading the leadership of champions. Don't matter that I just got into leadership of Georgia. That don't matter. When I come in here, all that go out the door. It don't matter that I went to the North. When I come in here, It don't matter that I played basketball for Plain College, got a SIAC rank. It don't matter. When I come in here, he said, you drop all that. You drop all your title. You drop all your prestige. You drop all that for me. And so then what happened was Michael, Saul's daughter, said, wasn't the king fabulous today? The king, you took off your kingly garment and you danced in front of, I'm gonna put it in the hood term. You danced in front of your little chicks today. You were showing out, you were extra today. David, and so David said, you know what, guess what? You just hate. You hate, you know why you hate? You hate because your dad, my God chose me over your dad. Your dad had a chance to be the king. But he chose me. So watch this. What you saying, Pastor? What you saying? What I'm saying is, Dave, see, the reason why we should need a cheerleader when I come into worship, that's the reason why. David said, because you got to understand where I was when he chose me. See, Dave, you got see the reason why I don't need you to pump me up is because I know where I was when he chose me. See, what David was saying was, I wasn't even in the line to be king. And so but he still chose me. See, when you realize you've been chosen, you're giving what's due to him. See, y'all ain't getting it. When you realize that you were on your way to hell, when you realize that no matter how good they say you were, in a matter of fact, he said, your righteousness is like filthy rags. I don't care what you done did. I don't care who you done fed. David said, do you realize I was out in the sheep pasture? My own daddy didn't call me in. So I'm here to tell somebody, your daddy might not think nothing. Your mama might not think nothing. God say, still bring him in here. Because the oil ain't flowing on that one, but the oil going to flow on this one. I was out in the field. I was in the field digging. I was playing with sheep. I'm telling the sheep, they called everybody else in except me.
Yeah, come on.
You ever got ready to play and they just had to choose you because you're the last person left?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You just the last person left. I mean, I was like that for a little bit when I was a little dude. After a while, I proved myself. So, Davis, I know that he'll to be the last one chosen on the kickball team. Davis, I know that he'll for everybody to overlook me. But I still get choked. But when he chose me, see, he brought me from the back up into the front. And you think I'm going to come in here and not give him praise. You think I was facing fed time. I was facing all of this. They let me go. And for me to come in here and not be extra, it sure is a shame. I heard they test came back positive, but mine came back negative. Guess what? I'm going to give him everything he's supposed to get. I wasn't even qualified for the job, but they gave me the promotion anyway. So ain't no way I'm going to come in here and give them a two-step. You better hope I don't hit a cartwheel. We get too cool to worship. But I don't know about me. Let me tell you, my God. I've been shot at. I done had cat pull out knives on me. So when I come in and I say, Lord, thank you. I don't care who looking. I don't care who. I give you the praise right now. Buddy caught it. I didn't. Praise him. So we see now that we just an introduction. We finna go on ride. Amen. Oh, that was a good review. Feel happy. We might can do out the call right now. So he says, he continued to go on, and now we get to the part about doing good. He says in Hebrews, do not neglect yourself from doing good and sharing. He said, which with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. Verse 15 in Hebrews, he breaks up. He says, continually offer these sacrifices. Which means I don't just offer the sacrifices when I feel good. I just don't offer the sacrifice of praise and doing good just on Thanksgiving. So watch this now. Let me correlate it. So we say that sacrifice equals worship, and if he tells me so to continually give sacrifices, that means me doing good should be a lifestyle. I just don't do good because it's Thanksgiving or Christmas. I do good because he told me to continually give. See, I should continually be praised. I should continually be doing good work. And watch this, not just when a camera is present. Not just because the news going to show up. Trust me, there are more we do behind the scene than we do in front of the scene. Everything we do, to believe it or not, don't go on Facebook. Some of us are just Facebook famous. We only going to show, it was funny, I ain't going to call the person name. Me and Latrice were talking about somebody. She said, well, is a camera going to be there? It's bad when you know you're only going to show up when a camera done. So we get to the point here. He says, offer this every day. Every day. Let me ask you something. Are you a do-gooder? Are you a do-gooder? And notice this, Dree, is that he says it's a sacrifice. Which means there are going to be times, Robert, when I don't feel like doing it. Yeah. But there's going to also be time when I don't feel like doing it that he's still going to call me to do it. Because how I was brought up, when I got disciples in an old school holy Pentecostal church, and y'all always hear me say this, Charlotte Wilcox told us, what's an inconvenience to you is a convenience to somebody else. See, you got churches that, and I ain't knocking them now, because I know we got a young generation, you know what I'm saying? We got a young generation, so we were talking yesterday about millennials and all that, and I know we got business people here. I know the two coaches got to get back to their family, but we got people in here, if church go over 90 minutes, you hot. You mad. Now we putting God on the time limit. I'm not saying you're supposed to stay there all day, but what happened when the saints would stay at the altar with you and let you just cry out your guts at the altar? See, we trying to move and go to the game, but I need somebody. Sometimes you just need a good old, as they say, oh, good old belly washing. Yeah. Sometimes you need, you know what? Forget the Hawks, forget the Falcons. Lord, I need to just get with you right now. And then there'll be an old mother who wasn't even mine, who already got her green cooked the night before, so she can stay down here and say, you know what, baby? Just get it all out. I'll be right. My mama gonna be right here. Get it. I know he did you wrong. Just get it on out. See, it's an inconvenience, but Lord, I'm glad somebody stayed at the altar with me. But see, it's about convenience. I ain't got all time for that. And what happens is, you're not sacrificing. We are worshiping God out of convenience. I don't think it was convenient when he gave his only begotten son. Woo! So what he's saying, he said, do good. And so now he's saying, sharing. He said, sharing. Some of us are stingy. Yeah. I'm going to tell you what, marriage will let you know whether or not you're selfish or not. Especially you get down to like that last Oreo. Or that last chocolate chip Austin. You looking at the kid, everybody about to run for the last cookie. You don't like. You ever pull up to the window? You want some? No, I want that. You want no fried nothing? You don't want no extra fry? You don't want nothing? I'm just asking. You want no fried? I'm asking. You want a tea? Anything? I'm good, baby. I'm good. You take care of you. You get about 2 seconds from the window. Well, let me get a couple. I just asked you that you want some. I really think that these tests are inbuilt to see where we at. I just asked you. I was willing to give you a whole bag. So they either wait, they either do it two times, they either wait till you right pull out, or they wait till you get down to the last two or three. They say, let me get them. Lord, I pray in tongues and everything. Lord, I know you asked me, I know you said I'm supposed to die for, but these fries right now. I ain't talking about Burger King fries, I'm talking about McDonald's fries right now. These last fries going. Will I go to hell if I say no? Now you driving, your inside doing like this. You can't show it, because you show it, they're going to be like, oh, you can't shout now, you just self it. That's your almost, then you just about to just, you know what, don't nobody eat. You throw it out the window, then nobody eat. Gotta go home like Elder Whipple said. Just be mad then. I don't need y'all. We pray about them. You supposed to be saved. You supposed to forgive me. Amen. Amen. So it'll test you. There's some relationships that'll test your mettle. Me and Coach Groom, we bless our fraternity, right? And so it, I don't need you just when you whatever. When you come. Get me at 2 a.m, my car broke down. That's an inconvenience, because I'm at home sleep. See, we're talking about sharing. The word sharing, that the word for is koinonia in the Greek. It really means to fellowship, which means we should be in, when I share with you, I'm fellowshipping with you. Watch this. I'm gonna talk about fellowship next week, so I'm gonna hit it real quick. But what happens is, it's easy to share when you're in fellowship. See, let me take up for the church real quick. Just take up for the church. Because people get a church the bad route, this and that. And what happens is, people show up like on a day on Sunday and say, well, can I get something to eat? We can take care of some of that. But then you don't come back no more. You don't even come to worship. See, you got church messed up. Church ain't social service. Church should serve in the social community, but really church is for you to be transformed so you can go out and make a difference. Yeah. See, we done got these things. Church ain't defects. Yeah. What we supposed to be doing is empowering you so you can go out and do something. Now, should we feed the homeless, clothing? Yeah, that's in Matthew 25. But what happens is if you keep coming back, I'm doing more damage than good when I don't teach you how to budget. When I don't teach you how to stand up and walk straight, or at least you should be able to say, hey, I'll rake the yard, man, for something. You see what I'm saying? Exchange something. So what happens is people show up trying to get some rock, but they don't give anything. And then you go out to my these churches. You don't know what's up. See, let me tell you something. Jet College is about 200 of us in here today. That don't mean all y'all going to give when offering time comes. See, you look and say, oh, I don't know. No, somebody ain't going to get. And that's okay. I ain't fussing about that. What I'm saying, don't let the look the fool you. Because amen ain't going to keep them on. That water faucet that we drank out of out there that was broke, that ain't going to keep that on. We're going to keep that on and you come around and doing some sharing. Would allow us to have agape meals that nobody put in on it by some sharing. So give churches a little break. It's a thing called budget. What happened is you just don't live by one. So you don't know when somebody will do. Amen. So let me get ready to close this thing out. So it's got the two scriptures that I'm going to hit you with. And we got here. In Philippians 2, I ain't going to go with it. Philippians 2, I'm just going to pull the points out, 1 through 10. This is what he said. Let me read the first of it. You ain't got to turn to it. Let me read the first of it just to get you on, right? He says, therefore, if any is in any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, If there's any fellowship of the Spirit, see that word fellowship again? I'm going to keep going because we're talking about good works. If any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind. That's what I pray for the basketball team, right? And everybody else, be of the same mind. Maintain the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Watch this, what he says. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit. What he's saying is don't do it because you want to feel good, so to speak. Now, you serving is a byproduct of that is God's joy released in us. But watch this, I'm not necessarily serving to heap these benefits on me. I'm serving because he called me to serve. You understand what I'm saying? Some of us serve because we're codependent. I have a need for somebody to need me. See, that's why I teach the way I teach, because I don't want you really ringing my phone off the hook. I want you to be able to go into that word for yourself. And what that does is make a more powerful church. You see what I'm saying? So I don't mind teaching you into a place where you can say, oh, no, I can exegete that myself. I don't want to be your crutch. I don't want to be the voice of God for you. My main goal is to help you hear the voice of God for yourself. In the lead, I don't leave your house. I leave two places. My address and this one. And I don't run it like a tyrant. I serve. See, what this is me serving you now. Me serving you is studying, praying, giving you a word. Now, when I say that, you can call me, but what I'm saying, you should be mature. And what happens is you should be leading people to Christ. You don't have to bring people to get saved at the church. If they do, that's fine. They should be getting saved at the door and coming here for community and discipleship. So he said, don't do it out of self-conceit. Why this? If I go and help Coach Room them, right, I'm doing it because I just love to give back. And Northeast is where my heart is. Yeah. No young man, you can ask if anybody will come to you, ain't got to give me nothing. It's my duty to give back to you all because I'm in a part of this tradition. Yeah. I ran the wind sprint. I ran from Northeast to Bay and back. And by the time I got to a junior or senior, I could do it without stopping. I know it don't look like I was in shape. Play if you want. Even if you might outskill me, then you were not going to outwork me. I'm going to be, shake me up, cross me, guess what? I'm right here at the end. Whatever you want, I'm still right here. See, some of y'all can't fathom what Northeast at, and Bay is out here. And back. Car running by, honk, honk, honking, laughing at us. Then Matthew Coach Johnson get mad, weight jacket, with the weight jacket. Amen. Do not merely look out, watch this, verse 4, for your own personal interest, but also for the interest of others. You got to kill your selfishness. See, this is how everybody's needs are met. He said, having this attitude which in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus. See, we also got to have the mind of Christ, but this is the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ is that of a servant. Amen. When you read this in text, he said, have this attitude. Having this mind is the mind of service. Amen. Let me tell you, since the basketball team here, let me tell you something that gets you right. I saw the other day, you know the ultimate act of sacrifice to me on a basketball court, outside of assists, is when somebody take a charge. Uh-huh. When a joker sit down and then flat-footed, protect himself, and a joker run right over him, what you saying is, I give up myself for the team. And that's what Jesus did. Jesus said, I give up myself for the team. Let me see what I did. I can tell when you selfish because you won't step in the way. And what I did, you'll let me get beat and you won't sag over to help. That's when I know you more concerned about you than the whole team. I can bring an analogy now. You know what I'm saying? What I did, if I happen to get beat, I know you're back though. What about this? Also, if you know I'm back here, I still need you to play defense. So what happens is we got to have this mind in us. So now my mind got to be that of a servant. My mind got to be ready to do good. My mind has to be changed. Why did he say humility? He says he had this, not thinking it robbery. He said he was in the image of God, but he emptied himself. This is God saying, I'm God. I'm Jesus saying, I'm God, but I'm going to come down to show you something. As a result, let me keep moving. As a result of him doing this, he said he'll give him a name above every name. See, you trying to showcase some of us, not just the basketball team. We trying to do other things. But he said, if you'll serve, then you'll be all right. He said Jesus was able to get a name above every name because he humbled himself, even to the death of the cross. The issue is you too high, and you won't get low. See, he said, I got all power in my hand, but I'm concerned that you won't be able to share in the riches of his glory like I have. And I want you to get it. So in order for you to get it, I'm going to give up some.
Right.
See, this is how I was. I told somebody the other day. I said, I wasn't like a 20-point scorer. I was more like a triple-double guy. I'm going to have 12, 10, and probably close to about 8 or 9 rebounds. I'm going to feed you. Matter of fact, I get crunk off you scoring because I understand that I can score. See, when you know who you are, I don't have to worry about giving you your prop. Because I don't work on everything I'm supposed to work on. So guess what? If I got a good two guard, I'm going to keep feeding you. Every now and then, I'm going to take me one. The issue is I have to be skilled enough to make the shot when I take it. Let me go to Romans 10. We get out of here. You ain't got to turn. And it just said, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. See, there go that word devoted again. Give preference to one another in honor. You see that? See, this in the Bible. Why we don't live by that? Because we don't read that part. When we read it, my blessing plan coming. When we read here, turn around 3 times, count the number of wonders, and you're going to be blessed. Watch this now. He said, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation. Ah, they're so rich. I'm going to keep going because I don't hear you long enough. He said, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer. That word devoted again. Contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. So when I devote myself to a place, then I should be serving in that place. How are you going to say you part of something and you won't serve or give to that place? What you is, you're a leech. See, he said you should be contributing. And so anybody that come and don't contribute, by this, all three. I ain't going to say either or. I'm talking about your time, your talent, and your treasure. We need all three, not either or. See, we try to get all deep. It ain't got to be just in the middle. You're right, it don't, but we need it. Watch this. And you can, here go the witness. We ain't asked nobody for nothing extra for our Thanksgiving feast. And we feed 300 to 400 every year. Uh-huh. Why? Because the integrity of it. The integrity of it is I'm not going to beat you up by giving. Amen. Or serving. I ain't had to tell you to chip on the. Uh-huh. You automatically know, but some of y'all don't even do that. I mean, you. Or didn't do. You shouldn't be doing it. Amen. Y'all see what I'm saying? So why this? How can you say I'm part of a place if I don't give to the place? And here's the thing. I don't even watch. The only thing I ask them to do when it's all over is what's the total? I don't ask who gave. I don't even watch all that. I got to know, okay, we got to keep these bills paid. But what I'm more concerned about is people showing up and serving one another. I'm concerned about both, not either or. So he said it's a sacrifice. If I'm devoted somewhere, Justice, then I need to be at that place when they ask me. And here's the thing, I'll say it next week again, and we don't do a whole lot of churching. Mainly all we meet is Sundays and Wednesdays. We got the prayer on Thursday, that's optional. Don't nobody really come to that most of the time, but Shirley and Miss Sean, thank God they praying. And 5 years, coming up 5 years, we hadn't had a revival. So you can't say that I'm just tired. You tired of doing what? You tired of being lazy. That's what you need to be saying. I'm tired of not giving my all to God. I'm tired of making excuses. That's what you got to be tired of. I'm tired of saying I love him, but I don't give anything. How can you say you love something and don't give toward it? Love is what love does. I almost say dirty, how I call them dirty. Co-grooms. This is why we don't give, and this is why we don't share. First of all, let me say this. Jesus said, you want the greatest of all should be the servant of all. Amen. That word servant is doulos, which is the slave. Yeah. I usually say this on my show. I say, watch this. I don't worry about you taking advantage of me because I get the advantage away. You can't take advantage of me because I give you the advantage. See, when I have the attitude that I'm a priest and that I'm called to serve, it don't hurt me to serve you. Because guess what? I also hear him when he tells me to shut it down. Because see, he may be telling me to serve you for a moment, but after a while, he will say, shut it down. Can I use another basketball analogy? I'm a pass to you, but when I see, by giving the ball, I will look at you and say, bro, I done gave it to you 4 times. I might as well throw it up from half court. But here's the thing about me. I would instill confidence in the dude. I would say, if I give it to you, that means I trust you. And their confidence will go up out the roof because somebody believed in them. But then I will also say, I can't give it to you no more. What you better do is eat off that glass. That's what you better do. Tell somebody to eat off the glass. That means you better eat off the rebound, amen? But here's why we don't want to get out of here. The reason why we don't serve, Matt, because we're not humble. It said that Jesus humbled himself. And we're not humble, and we have a scarcity mentality. We thank God I haven't made enough. That's why we don't share. But if you understood the principle of a seed, you will understand that you always get back more than you sow. That's the principle of a seed. One seed, one apple seed will give you an apple tree with more apples, with more seeds in the apples. But you won't sow the seed, because all you see is there. You don't see the forest in the seed. See, the forest is in the seed. Out of one seed, so you don't see it. So you don't understand. See, we'll say he's my provider, but I won't live like he's my provider. I act like he's holding something back from me. And why did the Bible say he who waters, he himself will be watered? I'm a prime example of just giving. See, I tell the people this. We always talk about how much we're going to save in a year. That's good. Do that. When the last time you asked how much I'm going to give in a year? Because I'm real like this. And we'll talk about this the first week in December. Somebody's going to put it out here right now. He said, I give seed to the sower and bread to he that eat. Which means, my classmate told you that, if he see that I'm going to sow, he going to continue to give me seed. But what happens is, this is what can happen. Would I give, see, if he give me seed, I not have a discretion. Because I give one seed, he give me some more. I can keep some seed, but still get some. So as I'm increasing as I'm sowing. Yeah. But you can't see it, because what happens is you want a quick return. But some stuff take time. You get what I'm saying? Some stuff take time. And so what I had to realize, when I give it out deep, that I understand that he take care of me. This is what he said, Matthew 6, 1-33. He said, take no care of what you need on tomorrow. He said, look at the birds. They don't even sow and they eat. He said, the birds don't give nothing and I feed them. He said, how much more you who made in my image? So then he says, at the end, get what? Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness and all these things. See, we say that all these things is go back up to verse 2. He said, what you going to eat, what you going to wear, and where you going to live. So I figured this. I'm going to trust this word. I figured this right here. If you said, don't worry about that, I'm just going to seek your kingdom. Right. Now, when I get a little lack, I said, now you said, yeah, right. Your word said, yeah, right, to seek your kingdom. The question is, do you really seek his kingdom? Do you really believe God got your back? I'm not talking about on this foolishness we spending on. Because there's still a good stewardship. Well, let me ask you something. Are you a do-gooder? But I got to close right here with this one. Your works still don't save you. See, some of us are trying to work for salvation. But in Ephesians, it says, we are saved by grace, through faith, not by works, lest any man could boast. So even though all the things we do in the community arrive, I still can't come up and say, oh, I do more than that. Because at the end of the day, I had to have a mediator. I had to have a mediator to get me saved. I'm saved unto good works. I'm not saved by good works.
Right.
Now, will he take the fat that I fed the homeless? Yes. Will he do it? He'll use that. He'll use that. He used pagan nations to bless the people sometimes. Because it all worked out in his purpose. But he called those dead works. Give me scripture then, Pastor. Give me a scripture. I gave you one, I'm gonna give you one more. Peter. Go to Cornelius' house.
Right.
Stop beginning the word. Acts 10, Peter goes to Cornelius' house. He said, go to him. Why am I going to him? He said, this is why I want you to go to him. He said, your prayers and your alms, I mean, he gave. He did words. Have come up to a memorial before me.
Right.
But where you going, Pastor Johnson? But he still wants to say.
Right. Come on.
What? Peter gave. I mean, Cornelius gave. Cornelius prayed. So God said, you know what? At the end of the day, he's doing good. But he got to realize his trust can't be in what he's doing.
Amen.
Because if his trust get in what he's doing, if he ever stopped doing, then he'll question whether or not he's saved.
Right.
And you can never do enough to really ease your conscience. There's some things that I've done that every now and then, guess what? I got to put the blood back on my own mind.
That's right.
Yeah. No matter how much I do, I still see the wrong that come up in my head every now and then. And just like you, I got to put my trust in the fact of the Savior. It ain't how many I fed. It ain't if I go help them man practice. It's what he did for me. Everybody, you're not saved by your works.
Right.
He said, Peter, go tell Cornelius. Go tell Cornelius about my love. Go tell him about the power. He said, I know he gave, but guess what? Because he did give, this is why I'm sending him the message.
Right. That's right. That's it.
Because I don't want him to go to hell. I don't want him to think he can pay me off. I don't want him to think because he write a $100 check. I don't want him to think because he fed some homeless people. I don't want him to think because he Yeah, they tell them that's a byproduct of who they supposed to be anyway.
Yeah.
He said, but what I want them to know is that he's separated from me. No matter how many people he mentor, no matter how many people no matter how many little kids he send to account, no matter how many homeless people, no matter how many shelters he helped build, no matter all that. Tell him at the end of the day, he still got to come through Jesus.
That's right.
Him no matter how many women he done had.
That's right.
Tell him no matter how many women, it all don't matter to me. If he don't come through me, he'll never see eternity.
That's right.
He can do all he wants. He can give to the home. He can do it all. But he need to know me. He need to know me, Kim. If he don't know me, if he don't know the death, burial, resurrection of my son,
that's right.
I don't care how good he been. Stand to your feet.